A very good evening. You are watching Rajya Sabha Television. I'm Smriti Rastogi with News Tonight. Let's begin the bulletin with the top headlines. Smriti Irani loses information and broadcasting portfolio. Piyush Goyal to look after finance ministry as additional charge in place of Arun Jaitley, who is recuperating from kidney transplant surgery. Karnataka election results for 222 seats to be declared tomorrow. Watch the counting of the votes and all the expert analysis live on Rajya Sabha Television from 8 a.m. onwards. A 3,000-page Delhi police charge sheet claims that Shashi Tharoor abetted suicide of his wife Sunanda Pushkar. The Congress MP says he will contest the charge vigorously. CBI files first charge sheet in 13,500 crore Punjab National Bank fraud case. Along with main accused Nirav Modi, investigative agency names then-bank CEO Usha Anantha Subramanian, executive directors K.V. Brahmaji Rao, Sanjeev Sharan and general manager Nihal Ahad. And 12 killed in panchayat election violence in West Bengal, over 40 people injured in clashes between the workers of the political parties in many places. Centre seeks report from the state government. In a surprise development, some key portfolios in the Modi cabinet were changed late tonight. Union Minister Piyush Goyal was given additional charge of the finance ministry in place of Arun Jaitley, who is recuperating from a successful kidney transplant surgery. Minister of State Rajyavardhan Rathore has been given independent charge of Information and Broadcasting Ministry. The portfolio has been taken away from Smriti Irani, who has now been left with the Textile Ministry alone. S.S. Ahluwalia, Minister of State, has been relieved of the charge of Ministry of Drinking Water and Sanitation and assigned the portfolio of Ministry of State in the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology. Alphonse Kananthanam, Minister of State, on the other hand, has been relieved of the charge of the Minister of State in the Ministry of Electronics. Alphonse left with independent charge of tourism. And now all the election news from Karnataka. Results of the Karnataka Assembly elections will be declared on Tuesday. Counting of votes will start at 8 a.m. Heavy security has been put in place at the counting centres. You can watch the live coverage of the high-octane Karnataka battle throughout the day on Rajya Sabha Television. Our reporters on the ground as well as eminent experts will join us in the studio from 7 a.m. onwards.
Counting of votes for the Karnataka Assembly elections will begin at 8 a.m. on Tuesday. The Election Commission has set up 40 counting centres to count votes for the 222 assembly constituencies that faced polls on the 12th of May. Elaborate security arrangements have been made at and around the counting centres. Except for candidates, agents who have authorised passes from respective political parties and media persons, counting centres will be out of bounds for the public. Over 100 police and a company of CRPF personnel will be deployed at each counting centre. Prohibitory orders will remain in effect until late night on Tuesday. While the trends will begin to trickle in within a few hours of counting, the final results will be declared by evening. Polling for 222 assembly seats was held on the 12th of May. The state recorded the highest ever polling of 72.36%, beating the previous best of 71.13% recorded in 1978 and 71.45% in the 2013 elections. All three political parties in the fray, the BJP, the Congress and the JDS, have exuded confidence of a victory for their parties, although a number of exit polls have predicted a hung assembly in Karnataka, with the JDS playing the role of the kingmaker. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
And for more on this, we'll go across to our correspondent Kriti Mishra, who is joining us live from Mysuru. Kriti, tomorrow is the D-Day. Verdict for Karnataka will be out. What are the preparations been made for the counting tomorrow?
C. Security has been beefed up by the Election Commission. There are 38 counting centres that are critical, and the Election Commission would keep a hawk-eye vigil on all of them. There would be three-tier security, so the inner layer would be manned by paramilitary forces, the middle layer would be manned by Karnataka State Reserve Police Force, and the outer layer would be manned by police personnel, the local police personnel. So certainly the Election Commission has taken all steps to ensure that peaceful counting takes place tomorrow. Smriti?
It turned out to be a very interesting day today, Kriti, with all the political reactions and statements coming in. Any hints or clues from the ground which you are able to gauge for tomorrow's results?
Smriti, Karnataka recorded the highest voter turnout in 2018, and political observers point out that this does not augur well for the incumbent government. In fact, we've seen the exit polls also pointing towards a hung or a fractured mandate. In fact, for the last 3 decades, Karnataka has not reposed confidence in the incumbent government. Nonetheless, we should not also forget that Karnataka bucks the national trend also. It doesn't follow the national trend. And we've seen all the political activities happening for last so many days. In fact, today, Chief Minister Siddaramaiah gave a very interesting hint, saying that he would not mind stepping aside if the party high command decides for a Dalit face. So there is speculation that the Congress or the Congress and the JDS might be in talks because we've seen exit polls pointing out towards a hung assembly. The BJP, meanwhile, is absolutely confident, and we've seen Chief Ministerial face of the BJP, Yediyurappa, claiming that he would be sworn in, and he also mentions the time and date. So certainly all political parties are exuding confidence, but a clearer picture would emerge tomorrow. Smriti?
Thank you so much, Kriti, for giving us all those details. So tomorrow is the D-Day for Karnataka. Results for 222 assembly seats will be declared tomorrow. Election Commission has made extensive arrangements to ensure that everything is in place. Security has been beefed up in the state to ensure free and fair results come out. And of course, as far as Rajya Sabha television is concerned, we are getting you all the ground reports and details tomorrow from 7 o'clock in the morning. Rajya Sabha television will get you an extensive coverage. Our reporters are there on the field, and of course, a panel of experts will be there in the studio with us. And you can watch the complete analysis with us on Rajya Sabha television. On to some more developments. Prime Minister Narendra Modi is set to travel to Russia on 21st of May for an informal summit with Russian President Vladimir Putin. The Ministry of External Affairs announced on Monday that the informal summit will be held in Russian city of Sochi. The MEA said in a statement that the summit will be an important occasion for the two leaders to exchange views on international matters in a broad and long-term perspective. Prime Minister Modi's visit to Russia will be aimed at further strengthening the special and privileged strategic partnership with Russia. The MEA said that the informal summit in Sochi between Prime Minister Modi and Russian President Putin is in keeping with the tradition of regular consultations between India and Russia at the highest levels. Last month, Prime Minister Modi held an informal meeting with Chinese President Xi Jinping in China's Wuhan city. The Finance Ministry asked the board of Allahabad Bank to take away all powers of the managing director and CEO Usha Ananthasubramanian. This after the Central Bureau of Investigation filed charges against her in the alleged fraud at the Punjab National Bank. The board of Punjab National Bank has also been asked to divest all powers of the two executive directors who were named in the charge sheet. The announcement came within hours of CBI filing its first charge sheet against absconding accused Nirav Modi and several others following an investigation into the $2 billion fraud at state-run Punjab National Bank. The charge sheet has detailed the alleged role of the former PNB chief Ananthasubramanian, who is now Allahabad Bank CEO and MD, in the scam.
हमने ये कहा है कि आप जो भी कार्य इन अधिकारियों को दिए गए हैं उनसे इमीडिएटली हटा दिए जाएं। हमारा प्रस्ताव बोर्ड के लिए ये है। एंड बोर्ड हैज़ डिसाइडेड टू डाइवेस्ट ईडीज ऑफ फंक्शनल एंड फाइनेंशियल रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटीज़ and have also requested government to replace them.
And now the news from the West Bengal. The centre sought a report from the West Bengal government on the violence during the panchayat polls, in which at least 12 people were killed and 43 were injured. The state government has told to provide a detailed report on the circumstances leading to the violence and the steps taken to restore peace and punish those involved in the violence. Despite massive security arrangements, widespread violence marred the panchayat polls. Clashes between the supporters of the ruling Trinamool Congress and the opposition parties occurred in many parts of the state, including North and South 24 Pargana, Nadia, Murshidabad and South Dinajpur districts. Counting will take place on May 17th. The panchayat polls are the last major elections to be witnessed by the state before Lok Sabha elections in 2019.
Today, the panchayat election process was held in West Bengal. There were a few sporadic incidents, but nothing major has happened. There have been a few incidents of death, but we think that any death is unfortunate. But this year, this panchayat election, the number of deaths and the incidents of violence have been much less than the previous panchayat elections, as you can easily see from the media reports itself.
This sort of politics that has been rampant in Bengal for some time now is reaching a crescendo. These are nothing but clear fascistic methods. Along with the people of Bengal, this is going to be fought back. We are going to fight it back and restore democracy and peace and normalcy in the state.
Today's violence in West Bengal in the Panchayati Raj elections is highly condemnable and deplorable act. And this also signifies that a culture of political violence which has emerged during the TMC rule, which has now engulfed the entire Bengal, and that is definitely a very alarming sign for democracy.
The centre on Monday submitted the draft Kaveri Management Scheme to the Supreme Court. The draft scheme is aimed at ensuring smooth distribution of water between Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Kerala and Puducherry. The Supreme Court bench said that they need to examine whether the said scheme is in consonance with the Apex Court's judgment. The Apex Court has fixed May 16th as the next date of hearing. The Apex Court on May 8th summoned the Secretary of the Union Water Resources Ministry to appear before it with the draft scheme. The top court had also warned the centre that it was in sheer contempt of the February 16th verdict by not framing the Kaveri Management Scheme.
Yes, definitely it is a very great achievement for Tamil Nadu government. After a long legal battle, we have achieved and formation of a body for Kaveri water, implementation of the Kaveri water verdict by Supreme Court. We study the report and we will say report to the Supreme Court on Wednesday. As we hope, everything is fine.
On to some more news. Due to increase in fuel prices, the wholesale price inflation rose to the four-month high of 3.18% in April. According to the government data released today, inflation in food articles was at 0.87% in April 2018, as against a deflation of 0.29% in March. Retail inflation too rose to 4.58% in April. Meanwhile, the petrol and diesel prices were hiked today after a 19-day hiatus. With the latest hike, petrol is at a 56-month peak and the price of diesel has crossed 66 rupees a litre. According to the Indian Oil Corporation, petrol prices are up by 17 paise a litre in Delhi and Mumbai and 18 paise a litre in Kolkata and Chennai. Diesel prices have been raised by 21 paise a litre in Delhi, 5 paise in Kolkata and 23 paise in Mumbai and Chennai. The Delhi police on Monday accused Congress leader Shashi Tharoor of abetting the suicide of his wife Sunanda Pushkar. The police asked for him to be summoned as an accused in the 4.5-year-old case, as there was sufficient evidence against him. Tharoor was also accused of cruelty in a nearly 3,000-page charge sheet in which the couple's domestic servant has been named one of the key witnesses. Sunanda Pushkar was found dead in a luxury hotel room in 2014. Meanwhile, the Congress leader denied any kind of involvement in his wife's murder and said he will contest the charge sheet vigorously. The case will be heard on May 24th. And Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu today returned to New Delhi a short while ago after his week-long three-nation tour to Latin America. Vice President Naidu said that the high-level visits by Indian leaders to identified countries and regions of the world were affirmative statements of intent to enhance mutual cooperation. He added that India has embarked on such engagements over the last 4 years and this visit is a part of that well-thought-out outreach.
Concluding the three-nation Latin America visit, Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu said the trip has helped bridge India's high-level contact deficit with the region. Speaking to journalists in Frankfurt, Germany, before leaving for New Delhi after concluding his week-long visit to Guatemala, Panama and Peru, Vice President Naidu expressed hope that bilateral trade and investments will be improved. He said, and I quote, India's suboptimal engagement with these three countries is to a large extent due to high-level contact deficit. My visit is the highest level ever from both sides to Guatemala and Panama since establishment of diplomatic ties about 50 years ago. Former President Sri K. R. Narayanan visited Peru in 1988. I am hopeful that my visit would catalyze enhanced flow of trade and investments through necessary follow-up actions by respective governments, unquote. Vice President Naidu said the top leadership of the three countries has acknowledged the strengths and expertise of India in various fields and its fast-growing economy. He said India has offered support in areas of agriculture, IT, science and technology, space applications, pharmaceuticals, textiles and new and renewable energy. During the visit, 5 memorandum of understanding and agreements were signed. They include training of diplomats and English teachers of Guatemala, exemption of visas for diplomatic, official and consular passport holders of India and Panama, a line of credit worth $25 million to Panama to set up 2 centers on drug tracking and innovation, work plan for cooperation in agricultural research and cooperation in new and renewable energy with Peru. The Vice President said Guatemala, Panama and Peru supported India's efforts for global action against all kinds of terror. He said the three nations also reiterated their commitment to India's permanent membership in the United Nations Security Council. Vice President Naidu was accompanied by Minister of State for Tribal Affairs Jaswant Singh Bahor and MPs Tiruchi Shiva, Anil Desai, Kamlesh Paswan and Chaya Verma. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
Now the weather news. The death toll in Sunday's thunderstorm across several places has gone up to 71. Uttar Pradesh bore the brunt with maximum casualties. The storm left behind a trail of destruction. Similar storm warnings have been forecast over the next 48 to 72 hours.
Uttar Pradesh in the eye of the thunderstorm once again. High-speed winds battering most parts of the state on Sunday, leaving behind destruction, dead bodies and injured people. The storm uprooted trees, blocking roads. It was followed by hail and rain at several places in the state.
बहुत भयंकर थी पेड़ पलट गए हैं पेड़ फट गए हैं पत्थर भी आया है बारिश भी हुई है बहुत नुकसान हुआ है बहुत ज्यादा
Lightning strikes in Bulandshahr set nearly 100 of hutments on fire. Delhi and neighboring areas were battered by a squall and dust storm with wind speeds of up to 109 kilometers per hour. One person was killed and 18 others injured. Flight, rail and metro operations were thrown out of gear. Nearly 200 trees were uprooted. The thunderstorm and hail also struck Haryana. Uttarakhand, Punjab, Himachal Pradesh, Chandigarh, Madhya Pradesh, Jharkhand, Assam, Meghalaya, Maharashtra, Karnataka, Kerala and Tamil Nadu also reported thunderstorms at isolated places. At least 14 people were killed and over 15 injured in lightning strikes and heavy rain in West Bengal. 12 deaths were reported from Andhra Pradesh and 4 in Bihar. President Ramnath Kovind, Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu and Prime Minister Narendra Modi expressed condolences over the loss of lives. Rahul Gandhi also expressed condolences to the families of those killed. With the weather department warning of rain and hailstorm in Uttarakhand, the state police asked its district heads to stay alert and be prepared. Thunderstorms will continue for the next 48 to 72 hours over northwestern, eastern and southern parts of the country. Bureau report, Rajya Sabha TV.
The Council for the Indian School Certificate Examination declared results for the Class 12th Indian School Certificate, that is ISC, and Class 10th Indian Certificate of Secondary Education, ICSE exams. Girls scored better than boys and 64 students got more than 99% marks. 49 students scored more than 99% in the Class 12th exam, while 15 students scored more than 99% in Class 10th exam. 7 students from across the country scored the highest marks with 99.5% in Class 12th. Mumbai boy Swayam Das emerged as Class 10th All India topper with 99.4% marks. Candidates can see their results on CISCE's website or they can receive the result through SMS. And the United States opened its embassy in Jerusalem on Monday. A high-level American delegation, including Deputy Secretary of State, Secretary of Treasury, Senior Advisor and Trump's son-in-law Jared Kushner, Senior Advisor and his first daughter Ivanka Trump and Special Representative for International Negotiations, Jason Greenblatt, attended the ceremony of the embassy. The controversial move by President Donald Trump came months after he formally recognized the city as the capital of Israel. Trump, along with Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu, hailed it as a great day, which also marked the deadliest day of violence in Gaza City since 2014. Israeli forces killed at least 43 Palestinians along the Gaza border as they demonstrated against the opening of the U.S. embassy in Jerusalem. More than 900 Palestinians were reported to be injured, at least 100 of them critically. And more from the international front, days after Pakistan's ousted Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif publicly acknowledged Pakistan's role in 2008 Mumbai terror attacks, Pakistan's top civil military body, the National Security Committee, today rejected Sharif's remarks as incorrect and misleading. The meeting was presided over by Pakistani Prime Minister Shahid Khaqan Abbasi, who said that Sharif's statements were blown out of proportion by the media. The very thought of disease scares all of us. Though most of them are curable today, but the prohibitive cost of treatment is a damper even for the well-healed. As per the report of the Niti Aayog, 86% of the rural population and 82% of the urban population are not covered under any scheme of health expenditure support, and close to 78% Indians pay medical expenses from their own pocket, due to which about 7% of the population is pushed below the poverty threshold every year. To mitigate the suffering of the common man, Modi government took some concrete steps like moderating prices of some of the key medical products like heart stents and common surgeries. It has come as a fresh breather both for the patients and attendants. Rajya Sabha Television spoke to some of these beneficiaries.
Sunita is in her 50s. She lives in Delhi. An avid traveler, she loves visiting new places, making new friends and gathering new experiences. But some time back, it all came to a grinding halt. Her kneecaps had worn out, making her immobile. The replacement was possible, but the incurring cost ran into lakhs. She was in a bind. Luckily, it was during this period that central government decisively intervened and capped the runaway prices of surgeries and many medical instruments. Sunita couldn't have asked for more. She soon decided and went for the kneecap surgery, and that too at a much lower cost. The surgery was successful. Her hopes soared again. Soon she plans to travel to her favorite destination, the hills. She is happy and credits government for her recovery.
मेरा एक का इसका आया है मेरा 60,000 रुपए और इसका भी मेरा इतना ही है 60 के करीब ही जो है सब
कुछ तो बहुत कम हो गया आपको फायदा मिला इसका सरकार की नई योजना
सरकार जब फायदा दे रही है तो उठाना चाहिए उसका फायदा जो है जब सर पीजी में बेनिफिट मिल रहा है तो उसको क्यों ना उठाया जाए
जनता को फायदा काफी फायदा जहाँ प्राइवेट में आपसे 4-5 लाख रुपए मांगते हैं दोनों घुटने के वहाँ पे ये अपना 1.25 लाख रुपए में सारा काम निपटेगा दोनों का
Kapil is a marketing officer in a private limited company. Work stress is a part of his professional life, but he never imagined becoming a heart patient at the young age of 41. Some time back, he was hospitalized due to severe chest pain. The tests revealed that his arteries were blocked. The treatment involved stent implant, costing lakhs of rupees. Kapil had no financial bulwark to fall back upon. It was a desperate situation. The light of hope was ebbing gradually. And then came the announcement by the government drastically cutting the prices of the stents. For thousands of patients like Kapil, it came as a new beacon of hope. Suddenly, the stents implant became affordable. It was a new lease of life for needy patients like Kapil.
मेरे को हार्ट अटैक आया था। उसके बाद हार्ट अटैक के बाद जो डॉक्टर के पास गए आरएमएल हॉस्पिटल में तो वहाँ पर उन्होंने एंजियोग्राफी करी और एंजियोग्राफी के बाद जो पता लगा कि ब्लॉकेज थी मेरी एक आर्टरी के अंदर तो उन्होंने रिकमेंड किया कि स्टंट डालना पड़ेगा जो स्टंट की कीमत थी वहाँ पर करीब जो पहले स्टंट की कीमत हुआ करती थी 1-1.5 लाख रुपये करीब करीब उसकी 1/4 कीमत पर वो स्टंट मुझे डाला गया लगभग जो मेरा खर्चा आया वहाँ पर स्टंट का और जो स्टंट डालने का जो आया वो करीब 40,000 से 45,000 के बीच में मेरा पूरा खर्चा आया
This much needed intervention was made by drug price regulator NPPA in February 2017. It directly impacted the healthcare market in no time. Post moderation, the cost of bare metal stent used in treatment of heart disease tumbled to ₹7,923, whereas the drug eluting stent now costs ₹28,849. The MRP of cobalt chromium implant used in kneecap replacement is ₹54,720. And titanium and oxidized zirconium are now pegged at ₹76,600. The same devices earlier used to cost lakhs of rupees and the profits were pocketed by the medical companies. But now, doctors believe that lowering of prices will directly benefit the end consumer.
हमारे यहाँ पे उसकी कीमत जो मैंने किए हैं सबसे ज़्यादा 70 के करीब थी 70-75 कुछ और ब्रांड थे पर उसके बाद तो काफ़ी कम हुआ है कुछ लोग तो काफ़ी लोग ये कीमत चार्ज करते थे 1,30,000 भी मैंने देखा है लोगों को ले कभी काफ़ी जगह इंस्टीट्यूट में क्योंकि ये मरीज बताते थे कि हमें वहाँ पर इतना दे रहे हैं सेम ब्रांड का ही एक कभी 1.5 लाख रुपये कभी 1,40,000 रुपए तो उससे कहाँ 55,000 कहाँ वो तो काफ़ी कम हो गया गवर्नमेंट ने बहुत अच्छा किया ये तो
एक कमेटी बनाई गई है जो कमेटी ऐसे मैंने बताया NLEM एक कमेटी थी NLEM के हिसाब से जो दवाइयाँ एसेंशियल लिस्ट में शामिल की जाती थी वो ऑटोमेटिकली प्राइस के कंट्रोल में आ जाती थी मैं जितना समझता हूँ कि ये एक बहुत शीघ्र ही हम लोगों को एक और कमेटी बनाने की आवश्यकता पड़ेगी जो कि बाकी चीज़ों के बारे में भी एक उचित निर्णय ले सके कि किस किस चिकित्सा उपकरण को एक मूल्य निर्धारण के दायरे में लाया जाए
Meanwhile, Niti Aayog and Ministry of Health has asked the government to amend the drug price control order. This amendment, whenever it happens, will strengthen the regulatory mechanism and cover patented drugs and devices.
The basic reason behind this price reduction of knee implant and heart stents are that the common man can also afford it. And the government, along with NPPA, also hinted that in many more devices and medical surgeries, there will be a price reduction in favor of a common man. But there is a challenge lies ahead between the good quality implants and also the research and development for the new technology. In Delhi, with cameraman Kawaljeet, this is Panchanand Mishra for Rajya Sabha TV.
And with that, it's a wrap on this edition of News Tonight. For more news and updates, keep watching Rajya Sabha Television.